How about now? Contact? All right. Well, it's good to see everybody tonight. I appreciate everyone coming out tonight. I know this side over here was waiting out. This side over here was way down, wasn't it, over here? But that's all right. We're here, and I appreciate each and every one being here tonight. I hope and pray everyone's had a good week this week. It's been a busy week this week, and it's going to get busier this weekend. So we're looking forward to what the Lord's going to do there. Do we have any new prayer requests this time? Any new prayer requests? Yes. Yes. Of course, continue to remember Billy. He's at home. I had a good visit with him this morning. He's taking antibiotics there at home for, I think, till the end of October, correct? 30th of October. So just continue to remember him in your prayers. Continue to remember Brother John Ed Matthews. Lift him up in your prayers. There has been just a little bit improvement with Miss Gladys here, but she's still got a long ways to go. So just continue to pray for her. Of course, continue to pray for Sister Fran, and she's still having a whole lot of trouble, pain and back there. And I know we've got many others. Of course, Don Garner, continue to pray for him, and Wanda, and a whole lot going on, brother. Yes. Pete Cole. Was he the one that was in that wreck?
Yeah.
Okay. Any others? Any others?
Don Ed, I saw Don Ed yesterday, and he's, I think they're going to move him back to Pine Lake back the last of the week.
Mm-hmm. Any others? If there's no others at this time, Brother Scott, would you lead us in prayer for these prayer requests? Amen. Of course, just an update on announcements. Oh, there again. Who had trouble with a one call today? Whose calls come in okay today? Okay. I guess that thing's just back and forth. I don't know what, but I don't know. It could be. Could be that. Just remember, Friday night, if you want to help decorate for the Hee Haw, be here at 6 o'clock. And, of course, senior banquet starts at 5:30. Okay, and then of course, the senior banquet's at what time again? 5 o'clock. So remember, senior banquet at 5 o'clock Saturday. Then Hee Haw following that. And then Sunday will be old-fashioned day, homecoming, meal on the grounds, cleanup. And then special singing that night at 6 o'clock. So just remember that. So a lot going on. Is there any other announcements that I may have missed? need to meet with right quick, if I could, with the deacons right after church for just a few minutes back there in my office. Okay? All right. All right. With that, if that's all, then I'm going to have the ushers come forward for tonight's offering. Then we'll have a congregational song and then some special music, and we'll get right into our study tonight.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us here tonight in this nasty weather. Father, we ask that you bless our troops, home and abroad, that may be in harm's way. And Father, we ask a special prayer for the persecution of Christians in other countries that are going through a lot of trouble now. And Father, we ask another special prayer for the sick and afflicted that are not here today. We ask that they get better as time goes on with your hands on their shoulders. Jesus, we thank you for dying on the cross for us at Calvary. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Like to get a hymnal, we're going to turn to page 180, Nothing But the Blood. Without that blood, there is no hope. Hey, trying to take the blood out of it, but without it, hey,
there would be no hope. Amen. Oh, a couple other prayer requests I should have mentioned. Karen's dad, he had to go have a CT scan this afternoon at 6 o'clock. So remember him in your prayers on his shoulder. And then also remember James Ring, the Carolyn Ring family. Remember them in your prayers. Donnie Shaw called me. Remember him in your prayers. And he was breaking up, but I think he said remember Atlanta Shaw. I may be saying that wrong, but remember those in your prayers also. And then also for one other announcement, remember Christmas Tree, Operation Christmas Child. The boxes are back here. They got your instructions in there if you want to pick up one of those boxes. I think we got 100 back there, if I ain't mistaken. So just remember that. Okay. All right, at this time we have some special music tonight. I'm going to ask Sister Jeannie if she'd come up with us for us tonight and play and sing.
Washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags.
Thank you. There's nothing too dirty that he can't make worthy. Amen. What a blessing. Huh? He made me clean. Thank you, Jenny, once again. That's an awesome song. If you got your Bibles, once again, we're going to be back in Acts chapter 1 tonight. And I told you last week when we talked about Jesus is still working on me. He's still working on me. I had just a few more nuggets out of this, a few passages was in last week. And then we're going to pick up, Lord willing, next Wednesday night as we'll be looking at Andrew. So just remember that. If you dare say amen, chapter 1, verse 14. Amen. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. Let us pray. Father, we do thank you once again for just allowing us to be here tonight, Lord. Father, we just thank each and every one that was able to come out tonight, Lord. And once again, we want to lift up those, Father, tonight that couldn't make it out tonight, Lord, for whatever reason. Just be with them and lead and guide and direct in their lives, Father. But, Lord, we're here tonight, Lord, a place that you provided for that we can come and worship together, that we can laugh together, that we can cry together, as I said before, and everything else in between, Lord. And I thank you for this church family. Now, Father, as we look into your word tonight, Father, I just pray that you would just speak to our hearts, Lord. Just put a renewing in our mind and in our heart, Father, for the rest of this week and in the days to come, Lord. And Father, I just pray that you, once again, that you'd speak through me and just have your will and way. Lord, let us learn something tonight, Father. Apply it to our life. And Lord, let us draw closer to thee and be that disciple that we need to be for you. Lord, we just thank you once again. And we ask all this in Christ's name. And all God's children said, amen. Getting different church folks on the same page. Think about that tonight. When I look at these disciples here and was studying this a little bit, I noticed that they had something that was very, very much in common, but we'll talk about that in just a minute. How in the world do you get people from different backgrounds, different ideas, different opinions, and my, oh my, people have a lot of opinions, don't they? How do we get people to agree? And the answer is this, you don't. You basically don't, in a sense. Because it's impossible to get everybody to think the same way. Think about that. But just let me tell you what the Lord does. And this is really what the church is all about. And listen to me. This is what Jesus does with his followers. We don't have to agree tonight and in the days ahead with one another. We just all have to agree with Jesus. Amen. That's the main thing. And just always remember that. How do you get a church to be one? A family, you might say, to have unity. How do you get believers to come together at the end, you might say? The answer is we don't all have to agree with each other, but we all have to agree with the Lord and his word. Amen. That's just a fact there. And when I was studying that, and that is exactly what you find in the first disciples, the original disciples here in Acts chapter 1. And we're just going to pick out a few more nuggets in just a few minutes on how the Lord spoke to me. Now, you remember all through the gospel records, guess what? We've seen many times that these guys here, they fussed a little bit, didn't they? They fought a little bit. They feuded. They actually jockeyed for attention and also lobbied for position, didn't they? We've seen that. Even these original men here that Jesus picked out. Just like everybody does when we all are living in our own ideas, our wants, you might say, and strength. But when we come here to Acts chapter 1, the Bible says there once again in verse 14, these all continue with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. After here, once again, giving us a list of these original disciples here in verse 13, if you'll see there. You see that? And when they were come in, they went up to an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zealots, and Judas the brother of James. We see that verse 14. And that really spoke to me when I was studying this. Because to me, that paints a beautiful picture here as I see of those few words there to me, because I see two words and I underline them in my Bible, that all in one accord. Think about those two words right there. Now, how do you get Peter? How do you get James? How do you get John? How do you get Thomas here? How in the world do you get all these disciples in one mind, in one accord, in other words, in step with each other? Here's the answer. These all continued with one accord in what? Prayer. And don't leave out that other word, that and, supplication. That's a very, very important word. That tells me right there when I see that, that prayer here, you might say, is a unifier. In other words, bringing together here. And this was the lesson I believe that these first disciples, they had to learn. And I'm convinced tonight this is something that we must learn yet again. Because I think our prayer life, if we would really be honest about it, is very, very weak. Because we've got so much today that gets in the way of our prayer life. It seems like we hardly ever have time for prayer unless we're in trouble, right? Well, we should be praying all the time. And good on that mountaintop, in the valley, and every time in between. So, you know, we're not, and there again, we're not living in Acts. And I was thinking about this. We're living on the other side, other end of the New Testament here. In a sense, we're living in the book of Jude. In other words, in the Acts of the Apostles instead of the Acts, or the Acts of the Apostates instead of the Acts of the Apostles here. We're living on the verge of what? Of the second coming of who? Jesus Christ. But I believe, as I was thinking about this, that the principle here holds true, and it is, is this. If we're going to see here at Emmanuel Baptist Church and individuals, if we're going to see God truly work and move in our day, then we have got to get in step with God. That's first and foremost. It's not about the preacher's wants, the deacon's wants, or individuals want within this church. It's about what God wants. Amen. That's what it's all about. And if we can just all get into step with God, it's then that the Lord, our Savior, will bring an awesome unity of one mind, as we see here, in one accord. That always precedes what? The blessing of the Holy Spirit of God. And here's just a few thoughts that the Lord laid on my heart that every follower of Jesus needs to take regarding this. First of all is, as I see here, I see something very important here. We need united prayer. We need united prayer. Today we have a lot of divided within the country and a lot of divided even within the church. You know that? You look around and so many times there are certain cliques, there are certain people, there are certain groups, and it shouldn't be that way. But as I seen that spoke to me. As I see all these original 12 here, one thing that I see here, I see sort of being united here. And we need united prayer. And we see a repeated emphasis on them all being together, on that. Verse 13 there, they all go up into the upper room. They all go, all. In verse 14, they all continued what? All in one accord. And then when you look down there in chapter 2, very quickly in verse 1, the day of Pentecost, you see there, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, what do you see there? I underline it in my Bible. They were all with one accord. So wouldn't you say that is a, when we read those words there, that is united. And we have to be united together. And the devil, boy, he loves when he sees the church doing good, when he sees fellowship and people growing for the Lord, guess what? He's ready to divide. And the sad thing about it is if we're not careful, he can actually use the people we would never think would use to divide us. He could even use me. Do you know that? He could use me. That's why we got to be careful about the things and being God's word. And when I look at this, it wasn't that they were, you might say, geographically just together, but they were spiritually together. And I pray that that's where we can seek and be, you know, in one accord and be spiritually together. Listen, y'all, know exactly what I'm, and y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. I don't have to tell you all that. You can be in the same room with people and not be what? On the same page with people. You can be in the same church. I know this. I've been pastoring a long time. But not be in one mind. You know that? There must be, again, united prayer. And that's what I see here in these disciples here. Hey, we don't always agree when we're talking to one another. But I'm just going to tell you where we can find some agreement. When we get on our knees and we begin to acknowledge that we are in need, or you might say we're how needy we are and how great our God is. Now, I can tell you what, there's a point I think we can all say tonight, amen, of agreement there. Because we're all in need, amen. And I'm thankful that I got a great God that can meet that need. And that's what we see here. Now, let's begin there with real united prayer. And then not only was, as I was studying this, it sort of jumped out, and it was their prayer, a united prayer, but also it was a continued prayer. A continued prayer. The Bible says there in verse 14 once again, they all continued with one accord. Do you see that? Think about that. The only believers that really continue are the ones that continue in prayer. The only way we can continue this battle, continue to draw closer to the Lord, is be continually in prayer. Do you know that? I truly believe that in my heart, because that's the only way we can go forward as believers in Christ, to be continually in prayer. Hey, prayer is what gives you strength in moving forward. Can you say amen to that? Prayer is what gives you wisdom to know that next step. How are we going to know wisdom? Be in prayer. Be in prayer. Prayer is the thing that keeps us from getting off course. Do you know that? I love God's word here, and we need His word, and we need to be in prayer for our GPS system to work. That's God's positioning system, you might say. And that's what we need. Praying Christians are the ones who stays right with God. How am I going to stay right with God? How am I going to stay in tune with God? I need to be on my knees on a daily basis, and not just on Sundays and on Wednesdays, and come to this altar when I'm at church, but I need to be in my prayer closet at home, reaching out to the Lord and just giving, you know, praise to Him and praying to Him. We've got to do that. And I'll just have to testify to you tonight, as I was studying this and thinking about this, that the seasons in my life where I have drifted from the Lord in my own heart and mind have been those seasons, those times where I neglected the place of prayer. And I've done it. I've done it. Because there's so many other things out there that gets in the way. Have you ever been getting ready to study or getting ready to pray or something, or the phone rings or something happens or something, you know, things like that go on. But I've done it, and that's my testimony. We need united prayer, but we also need that continued prayer. And then also, as I see these disciples here in that united prayer, I see them here in verse 14 in that continued prayer there. We need some impassioned prayer. We need some passion in our praying. You know that? We do. The Bible doesn't say that they just prayed there again in verse 14. Remember this word right here. How did they pray? With one accord in prayer and what? In supplication. Think about that. You know what that word there, supplication, means? It is the most intense word in Scripture for prayer. Because it don't mean just general prayer. It talks about specific prayer here. It means not just the motions, you might say, of prayer, but the spirit of prayer. Supplication, when you read that word there, it's a heart word. It's a heart-wrenching word there. It's desperation. It's a word, you might say, of heart cry. Oh, Lord, we need You. Oh, Lord, we need You. I do. I need Thee every hour. Every hour, every second. I need Him every day. And I'll tell you what we need to need some. We need some passion back in our praying again. Where's that gone to? Huh? We need that in our lives. Don't you want passion in your preacher when he preaches? Yes, you do. I love to hear passionate preaching, man. But I'll tell you what, we all need that. And that's some one thing that we definitely need also is passionate praying. Passionate praying. Crying out to God with supplication. With a heartfelt desire to be closer to God. And as surely as we need fire in this pulpit up here, we need fire in our prayer closets at home each and every day. Where are you at tonight in your prayer life? Where am I at in my prayer life? I got a lot to work on. So, you know, we need some people earnestly seeking the Lord in all matters. And I always tell you every Sunday, if you ain't got can't think of nobody to pray for, start right after service every Sunday and pray for me for the Wednesday night service and for the following Sunday, that the message that would be delivered is not from Mike but from the Lord, that He would use me in a great and mighty way. Amen? But we need some people earnestly seeking the Lord, and I see that right here. And not just praying on a platform to be heard, but in a quiet prayer closet crying out, oh Lord, my God, teach us to pray with that supplication, with that meaning, with that heartfelt desire that I want to be closer to the Lord today than I was yesterday. Lord, bring me closer, draw me closer that I might be that testimony, that living disciple, Lord, that others may see in me that, hey, I want what that boy wants. But sadly today, what? A lot of people look at professing Christians today and say, man, that ain't no different than what I'm doing out here. And I'm living like the devil. And then let me point out one other thing here tonight. And it's this. The prayer that these first disciples had was not only that united prayer, not only that continued prayer, and not only this passion prayer. But also, one thing I've seen here, it was a decided prayer. Decided prayer. I mean, it literally was a prayer that said, we're going to find out what God wants, and we're going to do it. So many times, we're good at maybe the Lord leading us and showing us in something that we specifically need to do, but we don't do it, do we? It may be a little tough. We may pray, Lord, put somebody in front of me this week that I can talk to. Hey, I've done it. And He may put that one in front of you that may just, you want to tuck tail and run the other way. I'll never forget down at Southern Pines, and I'm not going to call his name because a lot of you will probably know him. But he was a contractor, and I had heard that he had basically, and I know he wouldn't mind me sharing this, he was in the military, in the Marine Corps. And his drill sergeant just gave him a time after time after time, was on his case, Marty. And finally, he had had enough. And I think the drill instructor had enough. So they just went out back. And that old boy just wore out that drill instructor. Wore him out. Well, he got put in. You know, they rested him and everything. But finally, when the story all come out and all this stuff, I think he was discharged. I don't know if he got dishonored discharged or just discharged because he was a rough dude. Well, I was in the office down there one day talking to him. And he come in and he was cussing. And I done heard all about this. He's about 6'8". And, you know, here I am, a little bitty boy. He was cussing, you taking the Lord's name in vain. And I finally said, Lord, enough's enough. I'm tired of hearing this. And I know skin heals back. And I know it may hurt. But, Lord, I'm trusting in you. If it starts flying, you're going to protect me. And you know what? I went up to him. And I said, Dennis, I said, I don't appreciate you taking my Lord's name in vain. And I appreciate if you don't do it no more in front of me. I really appreciate if you didn't do it no more. You know, he looked at me, and I went, no, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. You know, he looked at me and told me he was sorry. He appreciated that. And he never cussed in front of me again the whole time. And I still pray for him. And I still pray for him. I thank the Lord for that. Amen. But that means when I think about this decided prayer, I mean, it literally was a prayer that said, we're going to find out, you know, what God wants. And when we find out that, we're going to do it. You know, at every crossroads in life, at every intersection, at every decision, you might say, Hey, every time we're wondering what to do, I tell you what we should do. Run to the Lord. Run to the Lord. God knows, God chooses, and we choose to accept His choice. Amen. A lot of times, oh, God knows and God chooses, and guess what? We choose to accept what we want to accept. And then that's when we find ourselves in a mess, don't we? It's been said that prayers not getting, and it's been said that prayers not getting our will done in heaven, it's getting God's will done on earth. I thought that was pretty good. And I totally agree with that. What's the context here of Acts chapter 1? Well, the Bible says immediately in the next verse, or in verse 15, it says, in those days Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said the number of names together were about 120. So here we see that Peter stands up and he says to them, we know that Judas is gone. There in verse 25, on later down there, what does it say? That he went to his own place there in verse 25. And he's saying, we need someone here to take his place. So what are they going to do? The Bible says there in verse 23. That they appointed two. You see that? Verse 23. And they appointed two. Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justice, and Matthias. You see that there in Scripture? They had two good godly men right here that could have taken Judas's place here. And now the question was, who was to take the place? Listen to verse 24. What did they do? They prayed. There's two good men there, godly men, to take that place. They could have got in a committee and got into politics and said, no, we're going to pick him. We like him, boy. He hangs out. He agrees with everything we do. Does that sound familiar in churches today? Politics is big in church, ain't it, a lot of times. But that's an example there. It shows me, what did they do? It says, and they prayed. Whenever we're looking for the deacons or for leaders or whatever at the church, we should be in prayer about who God would have those in those positions. Amen. Do you see that there? And they pray. Hey, the story of the early church was a story of what? Of praying. So why have we got away from that? Why is it today we've got to have all the new things, the cool things, the acceptable things? You ever thought we may need to be back at the old past? Where we've been taught, where we have been given examples in God's Word. But as I see that and was thinking about, when I think about the early church, it was a story of praying people. And that's got to be the story of the church today. That's got to be the story of Emmanuel Baptist Church for us to go forward for His honor and His glory. Amen. A story of praying people there. It wasn't about finding Matthias here. It was about seeking the Lord. Seeking what the Lord wanted. That's what it was all about here. And they prayed. And they prayed and said, Thou, Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whither of these two Thou hast chosen. Verse 25, we'll go ahead and finish this chapter here. That he may take part of this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Do you see that there? And I think about that proverb, proverb that says, in Proverbs, I believe it's 16:33, the lot is cast into the lap, but the whole disposing thereof is of the Lord. That's Proverbs 16:33. They had a decision to make. They needed direction for every step. You see that? They needed direction for every step. They did not believe. You know that? There may be some things I don't believe, and I need the Lord to guide me those steps that would honor Him. Do you know that? They had the answer. This sounds to me like a changed group of men. These are not the same disciples that we started off with back over in Mark chapter 3. Do you know that? It's not. They were changing. They were different men now when we get to here. Why? Because now they are recognizing that it's not about them. It's all about whatever the Lord wants. And we become that in our own life as an individual and as a church family to realize it's not about me and it's not about you. It's all about what God wants. Amen. You ever wonder in Acts chapter 1 here why they had to be 10 days of waiting? Why was it 10 days? I believe in that 10 days period as they were praying and seeking God, their prayer was being brought, you might say, into line with Christ's prayer. You know, so many times we want to make decisions just like that. Have you ever thought about, we need to pray on that thing for a little while. Seek God's will. In earnest prayer, pray to Him that His will be done and not my will. Think about that. I believe that their will was being bent, you might say, into God's will. So much so that when you get to Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit, what of God here, can fully come and the day of Pentecost arrives and God works in power that they never imagined. Never imagined. Do you know when we get to that point in our life, when we'll be in much prayer, seeking what God wants, man, we'll see Him move in a way we can't even imagine. And when did it happen there? When they decided in prayer that whatever God wanted, that's all that I want. And whenever we decide that in our life, whatever it may be, even though we look up the hill right there and say, man, I would love to be up there. I would love to be right there, but I'm down here. When we accept that God has your reason for being down there, where are you at that time? That's what it's about, right? Not what I want, but what God wants, and that's what we see here. And we can debate, I wrote this down just a couple notes here, and we can debate on whether one of these two men here was supposed to be the 12th disciple, whether that was the Apostle Paul. But my thing here is, I don't think that. I think the point is this, and I'm going to close with this. I think that God gives us this account here, that God gives us this story here to make this emphasis, that the followers of Jesus Christ, listen to me, must keep seeking the Lord. Do you know that? See, it's not about just coming to get saved. Oh, I'm saved. It's about continuing on in the Lord, right? You don't just come to Him and say, I'm a follower of Jesus now. You know what we got to do? We got to keep coming. We got to keep seeking. We got to keep learning. That's what I want in my life. But it amazes me today, and I'm right there with it, so many times we as followers of the true Creator of this world, we know much less about Him and His Word than so many other denominations, you might say, out there, that their God is dead. I want to keep seeking. I want to keep learning. And I would say tonight, I wonder, are you learning of Him tonight? Are you as these disciples here tonight? Are we all growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Are we becoming, you might say, nearer to the heart of God? Are we praying? Are we a praying follower of Christ? Are we a praying disciple, you might say? Now, next week, there again, we're going to start looking at the disciples individually. We'll start that. And I want to close out these last several weeks of studies that we've had, and I thank the Lord for them, of these original 12 by saying this. I don't want to say, and this is me, and I don't know what you're saying in your heart tonight. I don't want to say that I'm just a disciple, and I don't want somebody else to just say that I'm a follower of Jesus. With all my heart, with all my strength, with all my soul, with my all in all, as we've learned, I want to be one of His inner circle disciples. I want to be as close to Jesus as possible. And I hope and pray that you'll make that your prayer tonight as well. Brother Marty, we pick about it, but I want to be one of those sons of thunder. I don't want to be just something quiet over yonder. I want to be something that glorifies God. And people see in me something that, hey, I want something that boy's got. I want something that young girl's got or that young man's got. What kind of testimony do we have? Listen, prayer continuing in one accord in supplication. We want to get on the same page for God. Yeah, there's going to be disagreements in the things we may see and have here. But one thing we can come together, as I mentioned earlier, we're all in need. Amen. And we all agree that we've got a God that can meet that need. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we do thank you again, once again, for tonight in the study, Father. Lord, I thank you for just speaking to my heart, God. And Lord, as I think about my prayer life, Lord, and the seasons, Father, that I've had, Lord, and ventured out astray, Father, it wasn't that you moved, it was that I moved. And Lord, I see now, Father, Lord, I need to pray more. I need to be in your word. And Lord, I just pray, Father, we here at this church, Lord, that we'll come together all. And Lord, that we'll continue and we'll be united, Father, in one accord. Father, in prayer, in supplication, in crying out, oh Lord, we need thee today, tomorrow, and Lord, until you come back, Lord. And Father, in all the decisions, Lord, that has to be made here, Father, from the preacher all the way down to everyone in the congregation, Lord, that we would just seek your face first and foremost. Whenever we have something to decide on, Lord, it's very important that our will not be done, but your will be done, Lord. As we see here, Father, when they appointed these two here, Lord, that very next verse, sir, it says, and they prayed. Lord, I pray that you would move tonight. If there's one in need here tonight, whatever it may be, we're going to leave the altar open, Father, as Sister Cindy plays. And Lord, we just thank you and ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. Let's all stand. Do you have a need tonight? Is your prayer life not where is at? You willing to come to an altar and ask the Lord to make you even a stronger prayer warrior? We need some great prayer warriors in this day and time. Praying for me, praying for a sick, praying for a church, praying for our leaders here at the church. Ever have the Lord speaking to you tonight, whatever it may be. Father, I just come to you now, Lord. Just thank you for my brother Marty, Lord. Thank you for his testimony. Thank you for his love, Lord. Thank you for his friendship, Father. All of God's children said, I appreciate each and every one being here tonight. Such a blessing. I was sitting there praying with Brother Marty, just talking about, the Lord may call me home tonight, Brother Marty tonight, or Brother Scott, or any of us. And we should never take for granted that we see that smiling face, that person's going to be there tomorrow, because we may not. And the older I get, the more I realize how precious it is that I want to try to do my best to get around to everybody, but I can't. But just, it's a blessing to see each and every one of you here tonight. Know that I love you and I appreciate you. Hee Haw decoration is Friday night at 6 or 6:30? 6, okay. All right, just remember that if you want to come for that. Yeah, anybody that wants to participate, be here at that time. Okay. Anything else before we close tonight? All right. Know that I appreciate you, that I love you. But even more, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ loves you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Mike, you want to dismiss us in prayer?